Now, have a look at this. I've caught an oki, an octopus.
We don't see them very often.
It's a cute one.
In your net as well.
Let's just take a look at him here. Oh, come on, my baby. Oh. So, Matt, this is a really interesting one because this is not the normal species of octopus. This is an endemic species of octopus that only occurs in the southwestern Cape here. And it differs from the normal octopus because it only has one row of suckers down its legs. I don't know if you can see that. It only grows to this kind of size, and very little work has been done on it. We don't really know anything about them. We don't know what they eat. We don't know how long they live. He's coming out this way now. But the octopuses can squeeze themselves through the smallest spaces. So this guy is squeezing himself through a tiny little hole in the rocks. So if he can get his eye through the hole, then he can get through the hole. Finding an octopus like that or a cuttlefish on the seashore always turns the outing into a real treat, because these animals are amongst the most special of all invertebrates for actually several different reasons. For a start, they include the largest of all invertebrates, land or sea. So octopuses can grow to an arm length of 4 meters. And squids can go even larger than that. They can have a body that's 4 more meters long, but also tentacles that stretch another few meters beyond that. So they're the largest of all invertebrates. They're also the fastest swimming invertebrates. So some squid can swim at more than 20 kilometers per hour. They're also the most intelligent of all invertebrates, and you've probably seen that on various different movies. And there are many other amazing things about them, and for one thing, they're absolute masters of disguise. So if you're watching an octopus move around, it can change not only its color almost instantly — it's a nervous thing, not a hormonal thing — it can change its color in a fraction of a second, but it can also change the texture of its body to match its background. So it can grow little protrusions on its body or become very flat in an instant.
Yeah, how does that even work?
So it's sending a signal to cells in its body, which are called chromatophores, and each of those cells contains a different colored pigment. So if it gets the nerve signal, it can either spread that pigment out and then that part of the body will look that color, or it can draw the pigment into a tiny little dot and then it looks white. So nerve impulses can cause rivers of color actually to flow across the surface of the octopus. If they get excited, if they feel endangered, or if they see another pretty lady octopus, then very often you'll see ripples of color move across. And these are that is run by the nervous system. The nerve impulses go into those cells that will make the pigment spread out or contract in a fraction of a second.
Sure, amazing.
So squid and octopus and cuttlefish all belong to a group of animals that are called the cephalopods. So cephalo means the head, like you get encephalitis when you get an infection in your head, and pod is the foot. So they're head-footed animals. The animal has quite a strange structure, with a large head with very well-developed eyes. Actually, the eyes can see as well as a human eye. And some cephalopods have the largest eyes in the animal kingdom. So the giant squid has the eyes the size of a football.
Sure.
So the largest eyes, even larger than those of a whale or an elephant. And then the foot of the animal is divided into 8 arms. So you imagine like the foot of a limpet as the edges of it grow out and make 8 arms. So the animal can move along forwards by using its arms, or another one of its remarkable attributes is it can move backwards by jet propulsion. So it squirts water out of its body through a pipe that's facing forwards, and then it shoots backwards. So they're not only the largest animals, the smartest animals, but with the biggest eyes, the most intelligent, but they're also jet-propelled and jet-propelled backwards. So they're pretty darn amazing animals, and they're always really great to find and to look at. The differences between squid and cuttlefish and octopus is basically to do with their skeleton. So the cuttlefish has the most solid skeleton. So that's the cuttle bone that you would be familiar with picking up on the beach.
Yeah.
So this is a buoyancy organ. It's a bit like the buoyancy vest of a diver. So by adjusting the amount of gas and the amount of liquid in this cuttle bone, then the cuttlefish can raise itself up or down in the water column. So the cuttlefish have a solid skeleton inside of them. In the squid, that skeleton's been reduced to a thing which we call the pen here. So it's actually not active for buoyancy, but it's nevertheless a solid structure to which the muscles, the swimming muscles and the body muscles of the squid can attach to. And then in the octopus, the shell has been lost completely, so octopuses are completely soft. There is one exception though, one very special octopus that secretes a very beautiful shell-like structure which beachcombers absolutely love to find. And that's called the paper nautilus, or more correctly, the Argonaut. And this is the structure that it makes, but it's not analogous to the normal shells of other mollusks. It's actually a little nursery, and the female lays her eggs inside this. So only the female has a shell. She lays her eggs inside this, and then she lives in the opening of the shell there and looks after and guards the eggs until they hatch.
So like a little pram she's pushing around.
It's like a little pram that she can swim around with. And because people have known for a long time that octopuses don't have shells, when this animal was actually discovered, it was actually thought that it was like a hermit crab, that it had stolen the shell of some other animal and then taken to living in it. It was only later that it was discovered that the females secrete them in the breeding season. And then the male is a tiny little thing, an absolute fraction of the size of the female, and he doesn't have a shell at all. So that's another one of the really weird thing about these Argonauts, actually. If you imagine the female Argonaut to be the size of a female human, then the male would be the size of a large rat or perhaps a little squirrel, like sitting on her shoulder, and like, get off me, stop mating with me. And his main task is just to fertilize her, and he does that also in a very strange way. I mean, everything is bizarre about these animals. So he has a special arm which he can autotomize. He can release the tip of the arm, like a lizard can release the end of its tail when it gets threatened. And then he puts that inside the female, and then it can crawl along and then fertilize her eggs. And the first people to find this little piece of leg with this little suckers on it inside the female actually assumed that it was a parasitic flatworm.
It seems like a more obvious explanation.
Yeah, that's right. So it's got little suckers on either end, and it's a little wormy thing. And they actually described it as a species, which they gave the genus name Heterocotylus. So subsequently, we've discovered it's actually a piece of the male, but that special arm in the male is still called the Heterocotylus arm, because of the history of its description.
What a crazy creature.
It's a crazy story, hey?
So what do all of these creatures eat?
So squid, cuttlefish, and octopus are all carnivorous, but squid and cuttlefish live up in the water column.
Yeah.
So they're swimming in the water, so they feed mostly on fish and shrimps, things that are also swimming in the water. But the octopus is a bottom-dwelling animal, so So he or she crawls around on the bottom and eats mainly things that live on the bottom. So that can include bottom-dwelling fish like clipfish, which mm-hmm. they kind of surround with their arms and then suddenly grab. And they also eat mollusks, and they love crabs. You often see them chasing crabs. They have quite an armory of prey-acquiring things. So they can grab prey with their arms, and then they can chew it with their beak. So they have, that's another weird thing about octopuses and cephalopods in general. They have a beak like a parrot, a strong, chitinous beak that they use to tear away the flesh of their prey. And then they also have a radula, a toothed tongue, like other mollusks do. And they can use that radula to drill a hole in mollusk shells. So they will feed on limpets or abalone or whelks, and then they actually drill a hole through the shell, and then they inject toxin through the shell, which paralyzes the animal, and then they often take it back to their den and eat it there. And then they discard the used shells outside the den. So if you look at the dens of octopuses, there's often what we call a midden outside, which is a place where you toss your garbage, and then you can look at the midden and you can actually analyze
what they've been eating. Okay, so wait, they drill a hole, because they can't pull them off the rock, right? So
Can't pull a limpet off the rock because it's attached too strongly. So they drill a hole in the shell, and then they paralyze the poor thing, and then they, it loses its grip onto the rock or onto the kelp. They like the ones that climb up the kelp.
Yeah.
And then they just tuck it under their arm and take it back to the den and chomp it, and then throw out the garbage when they're finished. Throw out the dinner plates.
But I've heard they are actually incredibly strong. Like, they can pull open things.
Yes. Yes, they're very strong, and they're also very intelligent. So, you know, you see some videos on YouTube and so on where, for example, people will put like a crab into a jar with the lid tightened up and then give it to the octopus. And it doesn't take them long to figure out how to unscrew the top of the jar and get the food out.
And there's also
they are very strong.
Some great footage of them using shells and things as defense.
Yes. So they're very, very clever. So when they get attacked by, for example, a larger fish or a shark, they'll often take, say, an abalone shell or even a whole group of shells and then hold them out like shields to protect themselves.
That's amazing. So we found a couple of little tiny baby octopuses before. How do they breed? How are they surviving when they're so small?
Little baby octopuses have to look after themselves, I'm afraid, though. The mother looks after the eggs, but once the baby octopus is hatched, she actually dies, and the little octopus has to learn the problems of life and who's good to eat and who's an enemy all by itself. And it has to do that jolly quickly, because octopuses are very short-lived. So considering that the animal is quite large and very intelligent, it's amazing that it only lives for 1 to 2 years.
Sure.
So it'll grow from that little thing the size of a peanut to a couple of kilograms in the first year, and then it only breeds the once. So the male will fertilize the female. All octopuses have this heterocotylous arm, so he will introduce his sperm packet into her body, and her eggs are fertilized. And then he pushes off and doesn't have anything more to do with the procedure. And then the female lays the eggs in her den, and they're like little bunches of grapes that hang from the roof of the den. And then for several months, she diligently guards them and cleans them, and actually never even ventures out to feed again. So she basically starves herself while the babies are growing. Yeah. And then once the babies have hatched, she just dies of exhaustion.
Sure.
And then the babies just have to learn the ropes themselves. It's a tricky business.
What is a mother's love, hey?
She
gives her life for her babies.
It's tough being a mom.
The cuttlefish, are there different types of those?
Yes, there are quite a few different species of cuttlefish in South Africa, but most of them are in slightly deeper water. So although divers might see them, when you're on the seashore, you're unlikely to see them. There is one species, though, that specializes in living in kelp beds and in rock pools, and it's called the tuberculate or dwarf cuttlefish. It's only about 5 to 10 centimeters long. It's a small little guy. And then, as the name suggests, tuberculate, it's got little bobbles, little bumps all over its back. So it's a bumpy backed animal, just about so long. And then the unusual feature about it is that on its stomach, on its underside, it's got two adhesive organs like suckers. Hmm? So it can actually glue itself onto the rock when a big wave comes past and hang on until the wave has passed and then let itself go again. So it's an amazing adaptation for living in really wave-swept environments. Another really cute thing about this tuberculate cuttlefish is that it disguises itself as other animals when you disturb it. So if you turn over a rock and look at it, and it sees you staring at it, then it will pretend that it's something else. So sometimes it pretends that it's a whelk, and then it changes the shape of its body to look like a whelk shell.
Amazing.
And then it uses its tentacles to that very, very slowly, I'm just a little whelk, don't worry about me, to move off to the side. And then when it thinks you're not watching it anymore, it'll quickly swim away. And I've actually also seen them imitating a hermit crab. So then they'll put out four of their legs to look like the legs, four of their arms to look like the legs of a hermit crab, and then they'll very gradually walk away.
Like sideways.
And the rest of the body looks just like a shell, and they'll even imitate the coralline algae on the surface of the shell. So the shell will be dark colored like a whelk shell, but it'll have little purple patches of it on it like pieces of coralline algae.
I'm just thinking about that, like they must see these things, remember them, and then be able to mimic them.
It's an absolutely incredible bit of disguise, and you know, scientists have experimented with this, and if you put, for example, octopus or a cuttlefish on like a parquet flooring, you know, flooring that's made up of little squares, it's able to even imitate that.
Wow.
So they've got an amazing ability to translate what they're getting in through their eyes and then instruct their body, which I mean, obviously they can't see, instruct their body to adopt that pattern.
I've also seen the little cuttlefish ink.
Oh, yes.
They squirt ink sometimes.
Yes, that's something that we haven't mentioned, is that all cephalopods, octopus, squid, and cuttlefish produce ink. And that's another one of the many things that you've heard that they have in their armory. So when they get attacked, another defense mechanism they have is to squirt out this cloud of ink, and then while the predator is confused, then they can just disappear away with their jet propulsion. So they're
like
amazingly
magicians.
Adapted animals. They've got all these attack weapons and then also all these amazing defense weapons. Well, I guess if you don't have a shell on the outside,
sure. You've
got to protect yourself somehow. Of the different species we've discussed, you're not really going to see squid in the intertidal. You might if you're a diver, but you won't find them in the intertidal. But you will find these little tuberculate cuttlefish, and you will find octopus. But they're quite cryptic. You have to look in little crevices and caves, and they're very often very well disguised. But if you do find one, just take some time to stick around and watch it, because they are really one of the most remarkable groups of invertebrates that you're going to see on the seashore. And it's well worth sticking around and observing them.